So this stuff, plastic, huge problem to us today. So much of it's being produced in epidemic proportions compared to any time in history. So much so we should have nearly as much as 850 million tons of this stuff produced every year. And it's only gonna keep growing. So how do we go from this to something like this? Meet our eco-struder system. So what we do here is we granulate up our plastics into this form, throw it into our machine here. From here, we have multiple heaters which feed the plastic through here to melt it out into these small threads or filaments. We then cool this filament here, move into our sensor to make sure it's of the right thickness, and then we spool it onto our device here to give us our final end product. From here, we can then put it into our 3D printer. So we decided to work with Plan International to see what we could do with this waste plastic to help in a humanitarian aid scenario. We finally put the system together and we're looking forward to departing off to the Solomon Islands. Although we arrived late at night, so we unfortunately could only manage dinner and then off to bed. But we were looking forward to the next day to sink our teeth into what we were planning to do. So the next day, we went off to meet our contacts at Plan International, say hello to everyone, be debriefed on the situation in the Solomons. And then we thought, full steam ahead, let's go source some plastics that we could recycle. So we went off to see some of the partners and their offices. Much to our amazement, we found there was a whole raft of broken electronic devices and things that we could use, which were surrounded with this ABS plastic, which we'd refined as our material of choice. So we had a discussion with the head of the office and asked them, oh, do you mind if we kind of take some of these? And then he said, we could do one better, have a look underneath our building. So we crawled down underneath the building and much to our amazement, there was a whole bunch of broken electronics there as well, computers, keyboards, you name it, one-stop shop for us and our recycling needs. From there, we then went on to the Honiara dump because we thought this would probably be the best site to go to. We kind of expected things might be similar to what we have here with all this segmentation of the different plastics and other waste. Much to our horror, we found that everything was all stuck together in one big co-mingled pile. This included organic matter, plastic, glass, everything. You name it, if it was under the sun in the Solomons, it was found in this pile. We went around the dump. We dare not venture deep into the center of the pile and just had a look and see what we could find. Again, we found loads of plastics lying around. Our weapon of choice this time was ink cartridges that we found. Those are prime plastic for our recycling process, and we found tons of those around. We also took a few miscellaneous plastics just to try out and see what we could do with them, and a jerry can and also a crate as well, which is different type of plastic from our process, but still potentially could be recycled. And to our amazement, recycling as we know it wasn't really going on there. They'd started to make a few initiatives where they were segmenting off drinks bottles and crates, which they knew were two potentially recyclable materials. But for the most part, they'd just formed a small pile of these in the dump and didn't really know what to do with them for the future. I asked the guy to put aside all recycle logo number 7, which is ABS plastic for us, for when we come next time, hopefully to make even more filament. So once we got all that, we went off with the manager of the dump back to the offices. We picked up some batteries and built our own secondary nanogrid system, which we could use for our extruders and printers, which Dan over here kindly assembled for us.
Yeah, so after we had all of our filament together and everything we wanted to achieve in Honiara, we then planned to head out to the villages. Originally, we hoped to go to a village called Lambie, but due to the fact that there'd been quite a lot of rain and cyclones around, there's no chance of us getting down there because the road actually washed away. So we settled to go into a place called Visali, which is actually one of the most scenic places in the Solomon Islands, I'm told. Quite a lot of World War II wreckage down there. So we drove in there hoping to stay at a guest house, but instead we ended up staying with some nuns. We got everything set up there and set our 3D printer up under the house, which was really handy location because you could set up the solar panels outside of the house whilst still having most of our stuff covered from what ended up being a few cyclones, which is really fantastic, and it was a great location. And after that, It was the next day, we then went up and had a bit of a look at the water supply systems and what was the big problem in the Solomon Islands. And it was interesting to see, I guess, you'd find parts where there'd be like a bit of galvanised pipe that would go into poly to PVC, and there was even bits where there was bamboo holding things together. And I guess it was nearly impressive how good the locals were at using a bike tube to seal a leak, which is definitely something we had a bit of a go at ourselves and were no good at it, so they were quite good at that. Once we had everything set up, we went out to the village and had a bit of a look at their water supply systems. It was very interesting to see the people there were far different from the people we'd met in Honiara. A lot of people were far more relaxed about everything, but at the same time also didn't really understand a lot of the things that were going on around them. They were very naive towards their water supply. Even saw times where people would unhook their pipes just to use it as a hose, which would often disconnect about the 20 houses below them, which seemed crazy to us, but it was just a normal way of life for them. But it was really good to get a bit of an idea of the problem we were facing and then what we're going to be able to do over the next few days to try and solve that problem.
Okay, so after the first day, we kind of scoped out a whole bunch of the different leaks leading up as far as the water source as we dared to travel at the time. In the first day, we noticed there was at least 6-7 leaks that we could have readily gone for, but we chose a leak which was perhaps the most challenging of what we saw there, bar the one where we're using bamboo to bandage up the piping. So this particular leak that we thought we'd address comprised of two different pipe types coming together. So one was effectively like a hose pipe going into what was a kind of poly pipe, and this was supplying water to several of the houses. We noticed the leak was quite dramatic and was spraying out everywhere, so it could have been the most impactful problem to solve with our technology. This particular leak as well, because of the nature of how much water was going through it, which you could tell by how excessive the leaking was, would be quite challenging to do from a pressure perspective. So it really put to test the ability of our design, our ability to use the recycled material in the harshest of conditions. So we found that they were literally just two pipes that were unioned together. So fairly straightforward case of a pipe connector that we could devise. Dan did up some of the sketches of the modified kind of blueprints that we had that we took with us, and we set about printing the first generation, being quite confident, quietly confident that things should work. At the same time, when we did the measurements, one of the elders from the tribe could not believe that we were going to manufacture there and then on the spot the pipe connector that was going to fix this. So much so that he decided to accompany us back to our premises where we had everything set up and just to watch the printing process for himself. And all I got was absolute disbelief in him as he kept seeing this thing literally growing in front of him over time from the plastics. So the next day we went off bright and early to test everything out and to see if it works. Fairly trying time, because when we put it in, we noticed immediately between the joins in the pipe that we'd made that there was some substantial leaking occurring. So a little disheartened that all the prep that we'd done ahead of time didn't quite go to plan first time, but again, I guess nothing ever does really. The leaking wasn't hugely substantial, but we thought we could identify what the problems were and come back with a second iteration relatively quickly. So we kind of packed everything up, went back to the drawing board, discussed a few ideas amongst the team, and then came out with our second generation one, which we printed. The following days, we went up with that new revised model, and much to our joy, everything worked completely according to plan. Seals went in perfectly, the tolerances were right for the pipes, and no leaks coming out from the connector as well. So triumphantly, we thought to ourselves, now that we had this, we could do it for varying different size pipes, we could do it for mismatching pipes, and we could do it for relatively high pressures, or at least the highest pressures that you would see in a typical water supply system. And so we're confident that this type of system that we've created could handle any of the other leaks that would be out there. After that, because we were on a tight schedule, because we were only in the jungles for about 5 days, we wanted to source out what other opportunities were available to us to apply our 3D printing technology. So one of the other major sources of water leaks come from taps. And much to our amazement, a lot of the taps there didn't have any adequate seals in them, and so we're gushing out the equivalent of about a bucket of water every 2 to 3 minutes, surprisingly, which is a huge drain on the water supply system. We went back to our old friend the jerry can and thought, let's have a go at printing with this, despite not having optimized this technique. The part which we sourced out that we needed was a relatively small part, but required something with some elasticity in it. Normally you would use nylon, in this case we'd use the HDPE. So after a few trials we managed to print something out and test it out, and on iteration 3 we managed to hit the nail right on the head and completely stop the leak from the source. So we did this to a couple of different taps that we found this occurring to, and yeah, again, have proven there's more opportunities available to us with regards to water and sanitation and improving the supply system there using 3D printing. So beyond the use of 3D printing for water and sanitation, we also explored some of the culturally significant aspects and opportunities of applying the recycled waste technology for the people in the Solomon Islands. And some of the interesting things that we explored were the production of jewelry. So we 3D printed up some pendants and used the jerry can, our old friend again, to use a string and for bindings for bracelets as well. We also explored weaving. Weaving is quite a huge part of the culture over on the Solomon Islands. And so one of the volunteers, Debbie, she wove up a basket for us from that same jerry can plastic. So the interesting part of this is that there's potential business opportunities for the people on the Solomon Islands to exploit what otherwise is waste and turn that into an industry that could generate revenue. So overall, undoubtedly the project was a resounding success. We managed to achieve our primary objectives, which was to source out waste plastics which were amenable to our recycling process, to 3D print with these, and to solve some of the challenges that we would face in terms of water and sanitation. So we made the pipe connectors, we made the seals for the taps. We also showed wider opportunities which would play on culturally significant opportunities for the people in the Solomon Islands. So what we found when we spoke to the people there, they were just absolutely blown away by this technology. They thought we were lying when we said we were going to manufacture things for them there and then in the jungle, you know, where they have no electricity, using our solar system, which in and itself, even for here, was quite an amazing feat. But they thought we'd just nipped off to a shop and got a pipe connector that we put in there. And it was only when the elders came back saying, I saw this with my own eyes, this thing being made in front of me. And he started speculating about the opportunities of what was there, applying his imagination to, oh, what other problems could we solve with this? And we believe we've only scratched the surface of what potentially could be achieved. In Honiara alone, we could be creating a whole entire industry surrounding the collection of waste, segregation of that waste, processing of this into a form which we could use, be it for 3D printing, be it for wider other opportunities. And we think that this type of system, the possibilities are limitless.